I would like to invite Dr. Aziz Sonawala for his talk on outcome and impact of headache training in Pakistan. He's a consultant neurologist and headache specialist.
Unfortunately, this is the last talk before lunch, and whenever you are traveling and you know that you are about to reach your destination and the pilot announces it, I think the last few minutes are spent in packing your bags and getting ready. And the last thing you want to know is, you know, how are you going to manage headaches? That itself is going to give you headaches. So if you can bear with me, this is the topic. The basic topic was outcome of headache training course. But I will be focusing basically on the preliminary description of the project that we undertook, because I don't have the data of the outcome of what we did, but I'm basically going to describe what we did for headache training in Pakistan and why we did it. In neurology, we considered headache as an orphan subject, because headache is a problem that has no signs. I mean, someone tells you that he has a headache and you try to examine him, there's nothing. And plus, of course, it's not again glamorous, because there is no mortality. I think it's people complain and that's about it. But really, if you look at the burden of headache disorders, and these are statistics that are available from abroad. Unfortunately, we don't have statistics in Pakistan. So 46% of the population at any given time would have an acute headache disorder. Okay, this is from Cephalalgia 2007. Migraines account for around 10% plus of all headaches. Tension type headaches are even more, although they are not that severe. Cluster headaches, chronic daily headaches, and so on. So the number of people affected by this disorder is enormous. And if you take migraine, which is a debilitating disorder, you have 10% of the population. So if you transfer this to the population of Pakistan, you are probably having 20 million migraineurs in this country. So you have 20 million migraineurs. Now, to tackle this problem is enormous. The problem is that headache disorders are common, but they are usually not associated with any significant mortality. Usually there are no hard objective signs, and you don't get any findings on investigations. So sometimes these disorders are not taken seriously, and that's why the problem keeps persisting. But ask the headache sufferer what's happening, and you know the exact, you know, problem. Now, if you look at the actual problem in terms of disability that has been calculated, you know, elsewhere, migraine is the sixth highest cause of disability, not mortality, but disability. Medication overuse headache is the 18th highest cause of disability worldwide. So the combined disability due to migraines and medication overuse headache, just two of these problems alone, make headache the third cause of disability worldwide. Migraine is more prevalent than diabetes, epilepsy, and asthma combined. So it's a big problem, although you're not going to get any signs. Again, 1.3% of all years of life lost to disability in migraines. In the UK, some 25 million working days are lost every year because of migraine alone. So this is the enormity of the problem. You don't have mortality, but very, very significant mobility affecting the quality of life. Yet they have been underrecognized, underestimated, and less than 50% of patients with severe headache disorders seek or receive appropriate treatment. I remember when I was a student, I mean, we really did not get any training in headache. But when we really went into real life, I think all headaches were being treated by paracetamol or, you know, some kind of a, you know, medication. I'll come to the medical education part. And therefore, headache is the least funded. Again, in the medical schools, you have the same problem. Only 4 hours committed to headache disorders and undergraduate medical training. And in postgraduate, it's nothing more significant, just 10 hours. So lack of education at the graduate and the postgraduate level is a problem. And therefore, even otherwise, if you really look at the populations all over, majority of patients who have headaches appear to be self-treating. And those who treat, go to doctors, unfortunately do not receive a correct diagnosis because there is inadequate knowledge, because there has been inadequate training. We figured out one thing, that if you really have to focus on the management of headache disorders, you cannot focus on neurologists. Neurologists are not going to do the job. If you have 165 neurologists covering, you know, the whole population, you cannot treat 20 million migraineurs just by 165 neurologists. So we figured out that the best way and the best approach is to train family physicians. So this was a project that we undertook. The reason being that a family physician well trained in headaches can treat headaches in the same manner as well as any professional neurologist, because there are no instruments. You don't need instruments, you don't need scans to make a diagnosis. All that you need is a good history. And a good history can be taken by someone sitting in the clinic as well as someone sitting in the clinic in a, you know, village or in a small district area. So our plan was to train up about 1,000 doctors all over the country, mainly family physicians. This project was undertaken by the Pakistan Headache Society and the Pakistan Society of Neurology, and we were assisted very well by the International Headache Society and the British Society for the Study of Headaches. These organizations helped us, validated our course material, and then that was finally taken up for training. So we had a core committee consisting of 12 neurologists representing all four provinces, discussing all problems right from, you know, the course material to the actual implementation. And then all of these presentations were sent to the International Headache Society and British Association for the Study of Headaches for review, comments and suggestions. Once this was validated, approved as a core material for training for our physicians, we undertook the project. 8 topics were finally approved. Obviously, we could not have, you know, a whole lot because we had a very limited time at our disposal and we were about to train a whole lot of physicians. So these were the topics. Mainly it was migraines, topic number 2 and 3. And then you had, you know, other headaches, including topic number 7, dangerous headaches. How do you make the right diagnosis? If every, headache is not a dangerous headache, but the headaches that are dangerous need to be diagnosed, and so on. Now, to figure out whether we've really made a difference, we needed, you know, questionnaires, and so we had a pre-training questionnaire, and this was followed by a post-training questionnaire at the end of the entire course, and a feedback form, which you have a standard feedback form as you have, you know, in any other course. We initially planned a large workshop, an 8-hour workshop, but then at the ground level we realized that it was not working, because family physicians in Pakistan, obviously they don't want to waste the entire day, you know, sitting in a lecture hall, because they have their practices to. So finally we had to condense it to a half day workshop, but it was effective. So this program actually started in 2013, but then there was a brief gap of 2 to 2.5 years for many reasons, including financial constraints and other programs coming up. So the program finally ended in November 2017, that's about 3 months ago. We held a total of 21 workshops all over the country, covering 20 cities in Pakistan. There were 2 programs in Multan due to public demand. There were 27 neurologists who were involved in the entire training program. And towards the end of this program, we were able to train close to about 1369 physicians, almost close to 1400 physicians. Our target was 1000. Well, we had constraining factors. Obviously, we could have reached a bigger population, but funding was a major problem. The entire program was funded, I'll be honest, you know, with generous contributions from pharmaceuticals, with a clear assurance that there's not going to be any, you know, publicity for them. It's going to be a purely academic program, and we were happy that, you know, they were able to cooperate and agree to our terms and conditions. Again, I think the other problem was the number of neurologists that we required for every, you know, program. But we ensured that we had local participation at the city level, as well as participation from the core committee. And of course, time was a constraining factor, because, you know, going at all times to different places also was restricted. And finally, I think there are other competing programs coming up. So this was what we did. Then we had a pre-workshop questionnaire, we had a post-workshop questionnaire, we had a feedback form. Now, the initial responses seemed to be very encouraging, but we realized that that's not enough. We have subjected all of this data for our statistical analysis, and we don't have the reports. As soon as they come, we are going to share them with you. But generally, the responses were enthusiastic. And a very cursory look at the forms suggests that, you know, the participants learn something. Say, for example, if there were 20 or 25 questions pre-workshop covering the course material, at the end of the course, the number of questions that were answered correctly were generally more as compared to the questions that were asked before the workshop. But we have subjected this to analysis. Let's see what happens, whether we really made a difference or not. Similarly, the feedback forms are going to be analyzed and see what happens. Well, these are just some photographs to show, you know, the participants as the speakers as well as the audience. And this is a copy of the feedback form. Generally, most of the comments were in the 3, 4, 5 group, and we're waiting to see what happens. So, in conclusion, our aim was to train up family physicians in the diagnosis and management of headache disorders so that they are able to make a correct diagnosis there and then and institute correct treatment. What impact will that have to the population at large remains to be seen. Did we really make any difference or we did not make any difference? We have a subjective assessment in our mind which could be wrong, but we'll let you know the results as soon as they come. Thank you.